Hey guys, my name is Steve and welcome to AEAC Vlog. If you're new around here, that's cool. This is actually a sister channel to my primary YouTube channel, the Airgun Exploration and Advancement channel, also known as AEAC Home. Over there, you will get full in-depth product reviews as well as around the world airgun coverage. But this here channel is my opportunity to get in front of you a little bit more, slow things down a little bit, and bring y'all in on some learning, discovery, and approach as I receive these products and make my way towards a full review of them over on AEAC Home. Now this here is the new Sig Sauer ASP20 brake barrel, and it came to me by way of Airguns of Arizona. So let me get you through an overview. I'll share with you what's got Sig most excited, and along the way I'll pepper in what I've learned about it so far. All right, so you're in about the $350 to $430 price point right here, and it all depends on what stock you go with. This one here is the Stained Beech, which is the more expensive of the two. If you want to save some money, just opt for the synthetic. Calibers, it comes in two currently, 22, and this one here, the 177. It measures 45 and a half inches long. By itself, it weighs 8.3 pounds. Scoped up with rings, it comes in at about 9.6. It takes advantage of a gas ram type spring for smoother cocking and a smoother firing cycle in place of a coil spring. It's got a nice ambidextrous stock with a butt pad. It has a dual stage, somewhat adjustable trigger with a poly guard and a poly blade. It has an ambidextrous safety, which means that this sliding bar to disengage and engage the that safety is on both sides of the gun. It's got a nice Weaver rail on top, which is also very good to see in a Springer, especially of one making this much power. And it's made right here in the USA in Sig's Newington, New Hampshire plant up in the Northeast. All right, now, Sig put out a press release on this gun that I will try to get up for y'all on Facebook today. It's got a ton of great gory details that you're probably all gonna love, so be sure to try to check that out. But reading through that, there's probably three or four big takeaways here that Sig is most excited about. That's their glide lock cocking, their wedge lock breech, their match light trigger, and the fact that their whole approach to marketing and branding the product is to be very accurate and very honest in the power that this gun is making. Now the 20 in ASP20, the ASP stands for Accuracy Sport Pellet. I have no idea what that means, ask Sig. But the 20 means that this is generating 20 foot-pounds of energy, and it absolutely is. For my test, this was pushing a 1034 JSB to 937 feet per second, 20 foot-pounds. It was pushing a 1065 H&M Barracuda to 915, 20 foot-pounds, with both of those rounds landing 25 yards downrange, still retaining 15 to 16 foot-pounds of energy, which is gonna make this gun a very good little hunter. Now, extreme spreads were coming in at around 15 to 20 feet per second, which means it's probably gonna be just fine out to distances like 50 yards, which I will certainly try to get to when I get into the full review later on this week and into next. Now, let's circle back to that press release. So Sig talks a lot about its glide lock cocking, all right? They talk about how it's very smooth, that it's very light. It's only a 33 foot-pounds of cocking force, which they say is the lightest in its class. They say most other guns generating this kind of power are kind of in that 45 to 50 pounds of cocking force. I found its cocking force to be, you know, for me, it was heavy, but I'm used to testing Vyraus and Air Arms and Hotsons and some of the Benjamin rifles, which are generating, you know, in these calibers, 15 to 18 foot-pounds of energy. So granted, this is making more power, but to me, it was quite a bit of cocking force, but it could have been because I was doing it for 6 hours in my backyard as I learned the gun too. It's probably gonna be fine for most of you. It's definitely very smooth, and it's also definitely very linear, which I found very interesting. So when you're going through that cocking stroke, in my experience, a lot of these gas ram guns, they'll be very heavy on one side, and then you'll get to the bottom and they'll kind of fall in really quick. It wasn't like that. It was very smooth and linear all the way through, and of course going up the other end was uh was very easy. Now, their wedge lock system, they've kind of redesigned how a brake barrel comes together and holds itself in alignment with the rest of the gun, which they say yields better accuracy, and I'm sure it contributes to it. But they have this new wedge lock system, which I'll put a picture up on the screen so you guys can check it out, which did for me lock things up very nice and tight. In fact, I found that when you lock the gun into place, it actually locks quite a bit heavier than any other gun that I've tested. So the pro would be that it maybe does lock up tighter for better accuracy, but the con would be it's going to take a little bit more effort to slam that into place. Now, when they manufacture this, they also talk about that pin that kind of holds this mechanism in place. When that pin is inserted into the breech, it's drilled and pressed all in one motion. And the advantage is supposed to be that it keeps this nice and tight and keeps the tolerances really close to give you better accuracy for years to come by keeping everything in proper alignment. So I thought that was kind of cool. And of course, before I move on to the trigger, you can see that Sig's also shrouded this barrel. It's not loud. There's really no report that comes out of it at all. All of the sound comes from that spring piston, you know, taking that piston, wham, right up against the front of the breech. And that's where all your noise is going to come from. It's all kind of sourced from here, not up in here. All right, the trigger. All right, some cool things going on here. So Sig talks about how they've totally changed up the approach and the design of how they made a trigger compared to any other air gun. And it is different, and I'll get into that. Now, when it first came out of the box for me, it was breaking at about 2.5 pounds. It was dual stage, it is dual stage. Had a pretty heavy first stage pull. The second stage, there was quite a bit of roll in there before it would break for me. But, you know, the good news is that the owner's manual that ships with this gun gives very detailed instructions on how you can tune that trigger to your liking. All right, now there's going to be two main adjustments, or really two adjustments period, for this trigger. One is in the back here, so you can insert an Allen key that goes into a little grub screw that's on the back side of the trigger, and you can control how long that second stage pull is before it finally lets off for you. And that's that roll I was talking about. So for me, about a half a turn in clockwise on the grub screw behind the trigger completely eliminated that second stage roll. So you come up through that heavier first stage, come up against the second, and then with more pressure, boom, it goes right off for you, which makes the gun easier to shoot well and consistent out at distances like 25 yards. So that took care of that roll. Now there's another adjustment, which is on the top of the gun. It's a small Phillips head screwdriver, which you have to remove the scope to access. And they've done something kind of differently here. So it's the kind of system where that Phillips head screw that comes up against the screwdriver, it's like spring loaded. So you'll put the screwdriver in there, you'll push down on the screw, you'll feel the spring pushing back against you. You start to turn it, and as you start to turn it, like let that spring come back up. And about halfway through, you'll feel it click into position. Now it's got 8 different click position adjustments in that back screw. You can go right to make the trigger heavier. You can go left to make it lighter. Like I said, it came at about 2.5 pounds. And as I worked, it took about 3 of those clicking positions to bring the trigger from 2.5 pounds down to, I think it was 1 pound, 6 or 7 ounces. So less than 1.5 pounds, which was great. But I also found that kind of interesting because Sig is saying that its trigger adjustment range is kind of in that 2.5 to 3.5 or 4 window. And I was elated that I was able to get that less than what they said. But the cool thing is if you keep going, you think you're going to keep getting lighter and lighter, you're not. It's like the thing makes a lap in there and then it comes back up and it starts getting really, really heavy again. So it's nice to see they've kind of built that safety system in here where you really can't get below, say, 1.5 pounds or so. So somebody can't accidentally adjust the trigger into an unsafe range, right? So overall, the trigger, you know, there's been a lot of excitement about it. It's better than a Gamo. It's better than a Crossman Benjamin. It is not where a Virow record trigger would be, and it's not where a trigger in an Air Arms Springer would be. And it's kind of right there tied with the Hotson as far as overall feel. Now, where the Hotson definitely has it beat is in that first stage. The first stage on this is just, it's a lot heavier than I would like to see. And when you get this trigger down to a pound and a half, you don't want the first stage to be almost as heavy as the break. Otherwise, it gets hard to tell where you're at, and controllability can become a little bit of an issue. At least it was for me. But the other thing it would be nice to see the Sig do is the trigger blade and the guard are poly. I have no problem with that. We see a lot of high impact polymers and tactical weapons today, so not a problem. But the blade itself is so wide, and this is such a powerful spring gun that regardless of what you've probably read out there in some of the literature and the hype, it took everything I had, and I've been shooting Springers and Magnum Springers since I was the age of 16, and I'm 44 now. It took all the skill I had to deploy to shoot dimers with this at 25 yards. Now, it will very consistently shoot dimers with a lot of different types of pellet as long as you stay up in that 10 and a half grain range. But, you know, just that big blade surface area, for me anyway, I had a tendency to want to pull my shots, especially trying to manage that first stage up against the second stage and their weights being similar. So maybe if there's a Gen 2 of this, it would be cool to see that first stage lightened up and maybe that trigger blade not have such a giant face on it. But I know I've talked a lot about the trigger, but that's because there's some really great things going on here. I do want to leave you with the fact that I was able to get it to my liking and to where I could get the whole thing to perform at a very high level. So don't worry about it. I've just read a lot of talk about it, so I wanted to make sure I talk to you guys about it. So I think I'm gonna leave it pretty much right there. And to catch the rest of the full review, it should be up on my other channel, AEAC Home, in about a week. If you want to see what I'm doing between now and then, you can follow me on Instagram, Hooked on Air. You can follow me on Facebook, Hooked on Air. I'm kind of using the Instagram for my day-to-day. Facebook is kind of like after the review. I'll circle back with a photo pack and some final thoughts for you. Otherwise, you'll see a review up in about a week or so. I've got some wind and rain coming in Friday and Saturday, so obviously I can't be out shooting in that. But yeah. That's the Sig ASP20 so far, guys. It's looking good. So wherever you are, whatever you're doing, thank you so much for spending that time with me. And I'll see you again, hopefully soon.